Welcome to the Free the Bear podcast, a podcast devoted to California independence, where two guys talk about how crappy the government is and how dumb politicians can be, and that there might be another way. So sit back, enjoy, and as always,
Free the Bear. Grrr.
Gosh, with the COVID, it's definitely a reason I think California needs to become its own nation. Just the difference in how we're taking it in this state compared to some of the red states.
Well, I mean, it's just the response. I mean, again, like, you know, Gavin Newsom has a lot of problems. And again, we've talked about this ad nauseum, but, you know, there was a very low bar and he went above that. The low bar was trying to make sure that people could be safe and actually making sure that lives were given priority over, say, businesses or property. You know, again, he's a very corporate Democrat. He's a guy who kind of zigs and zags sometimes. Again, sometimes I think he's a sleaze. Sometimes I think he's a pioneer. Maybe the closest thing in our generation to like a Lyndon Johnson, you know, because Lyndon Johnson used to do that too. You know, he used to have this thing where, you know, he'd be for civil rights and then all of a sudden he was giving his buddies all these like sweetheart deals and, you know, bombing Hanoi just for the fun of it. So it's, again, it's a very complicated character. It's not a very easy political caricature, as much as the right would like to make him out to be.
Yes, and I'll even say Massachusetts has a pretty moderate Republican governor, and from all accounts, he's doing well. I think, and we've discussed this before, the difference between political viewpoints and competency, you know, being an executive, and yeah, Gavin Newsom is a competent executive for sure. I don't think anyone can deny that.
No, there's nothing revolutionary about him. There's nothing that is going to be really changing the course of, you know, California history, except for, I guess, you know, his moment back in 2004 when he was not governor, when he was mayor of San Francisco and actually being one of the first mayors to push for full gay marriage, which I think in the history books will go down as like the opening shot that gave us the moment of actual gay rights and equality. But other than that, I mean, he's very much... again, this part of this Democratic machine that hopefully the California National Party can be an opponent to, instead of, you know, again, the Republican Party is a dead letter issue out here in California. I mean, like, the Republican Party is this, besides some holdouts in Orange County and Huntington Beach, which I can talk about later because they went to the pro-cop protest on Saturday, and then the counter-protest by Black Lives Matter. There is nothing really going on when it comes to Republicans. There's no statewide offices. The Democrats have a supermajority in every assembly, in every Senate. I don't know why I say every assembly, every Senate. There's only two, but or you know what I meant.
I've never understood why the Republican Party has such a stranglehold in Orange County and San Diego. Why, well, you've been here longer and you live in Southern California. Why is that?
I think it was a racial backlash kind of thing that kind of kept their momentum. But you got to remember that, you know, if you go through California history, California was not really the beacon of progressivism. It was pretty much Reagan country. There was a kind of shiny moment with, Governor Brownstad, Pat Brown, if I remember this right, if I'm going through my history. Pat Brown was very progressive, very much a kind of... infrastructure person. That was mostly what he was focused on, and he was somebody who, you know, he put through the college system that was, you know, pretty much state of the art for not only the country but for the entire world. I mean, the Cal State Long Beach, not Cal State Long Beach, the Cal State system, the University of California system, the community college system. That was his, you know, brainchild. And but there was a backlash to that. He went, in the eyes of California voters, he went way too far to the left, and Reagan basically busted him out of office on an anti-civil rights platform. And California, after that, was pretty much a foot soldier for the Republican movement in this country, especially the backlash to the civil rights issues of the 1960s. a backlash to, you know, kind of like, you know, the caricatures of liberalism that was being talked about at the time, you know, again, like the soft on crime, soft on the Soviets kind of thing. And long story short, that was always, that was a pretty good continuation. I mean, Orange County, where Nixon came from, that was the stronghold against the, you know, the, how do I put this? It was a stronghold against the Democratic machine in California, and actually provided enough wins to the Republican Party that they could actually were kind of dominant for the most part. Really, the only change came around, I would say, in the Gray Davis era in the beginning, but then actually then switched back to Schwarzenegger for a moment. But Schwarzenegger ran pretty much as the most liberal Republican you can imagine, so it really wasn't a true restoration. California, again, was for many years not exactly what California is, you know, showcased today to be. It really is not.
And you speak of Arnold. I always blunder his name. You speak of Arnold. I think in any state but California or maybe Massachusetts, he's a Democrat.
He basically, for all intents and purposes, yeah, he is a Democrat. But also, you know, if you look at previous governors, you know, Dugmagian, there was kind of like a moderate Republican feel. Pete Wilson was a total reactionary, however, and Pete Wilson was in office until about the mid-90s, if I'm remembering my history right. Again, never quote me on this, because, again, I'm sure Google will show I'm wrong in some way, but about the mid-90s, Pete Wilson was around, and he was also the author of, what was it, Proposition 187, which is ominous as hell, because 187 is in the California Municipal Code, the code police use when they're talking about murders. And Proposition 187 was a thing where the Republican right in California were basically trying to strip all care, or all public services from any undocumented workers, which basically would have been, you know, one of the fiercest, most apartheid-like systems in this country. I mean, you know, any undocumented immigrants could never have their children part of any kind of education system. Any non-emergency health care, no services would actually go through to any undocumented immigrants. It would have been just a total catastrophe on a humanitarian scale. And that was California. And California was pretty on top of that. And the voters passed that law. Probably his reaction to the fact that, you know, it was just right after the riots of the Rodney King riots. So, yeah, California was never really what you think of it today in 2020. Again, it's a very different place. But, again, Republicans had a stranglehold for a long time on certain issues, and it just sort of faded. I guess it's just a demographic collapse. I mean, people of younger age came out, and, you know, in certain numbers, they pushed for more liberal policies, and they do have a Democratic establishment that is overwhelming. But the problem with any kind of establishment like this, any kind of, you know, almost a single party system, which I think is the best way to describe California at the moment, when you have a single party system, the biggest problem with that is that you have something where corruption and special interests can easily kind of get their tentacles into it and start controlling it, because there is no opposition. I mean, really, what opposition is there out there against the Democrats right here in California? The only opposition in reality is other Democrats, Democratic socialists, people who are just, you know, more liberal than the establishment, that kind of thing.
Well, I think one of the funniest, I think also Republicans are responsible for this propaganda that San Francisco is the most liberal place in the world. And they make Nancy Pelosi out to be the most liberal person in Congress. Nancy Pelosi is really a Republican, or as corporate of a Democrat as you can get.
I wouldn't say Republican. That seems to me a little bit too far, but she definitely is the limousine liberal.
I'll say this. I would consider her liberal. I'll even say this. I can name a few Republicans I would vote for over her.
You got to hit me with this, because, again, that seems like an incredibly short list.
Ron Paul, Gary Johnson, Bill Weld.
Well,
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
I know where your heart is in this, but I have to frankly disagree. I mean,
bring it.
Schwarzenegger would be a good alternative, because Schwarzenegger seems that he always was trying to, how do I put this? I don't want to just give this cliche of like he's trying to do the right thing. but he at least seems like he was open to listening to people, and that because of his status and wealth, which is kind of a double-edged sword, but because of his status and wealth, I think that he was open to building bridges. His whole career wasn't based on politics, right? You know, his whole breadbasket is not politics. So he could have been a little bit more open with stuff. Ron Paul is a hell of a lot more iffy to me, because Ron Paul, who I used to like a lot, I think we've talked before about the Revolution Manifesto,
yes,
which is Ron Paul's book. And again, there's a ton of great ideas in that. It really is very interesting. And some of the viewpoints is very, I would say, thought-provoking and unique. But Ron Paul, the person, he's kind of, over time, has showcased himself as being part of that kind of hidden white supremacy that's always lurking in libertarianism. I mean, he had that, he tweeted that cartoon about cultural Marxism, and, you know, it was the biggest anti-Semitic caricature on the planet. It was, I mean, pretty much like, again, there was like a hammer and sickle there, and then it was like the Happy Merchant, which is a thing that anyone can look up on the internet, the Happy Merchant, which is, you know, the biggest caricature of Jews. He put all that there. So, and he said that, you know, again, he made a mistake, but then you go into his history, and the Ron Paul newsletter was talking about how, like, crazy stuff, like they should rename MLK Day to Welfare Day, and that, you know, New York need to have, like, you know, more violent cops to deal with these animals and thugs, and, you know. So Ron Paul had all this kind of crap on him. So, no, Ron Paul's out for me.
I'll counter with this. Has Nancy Pelosi ever proposed, or do you think she will ever do anything as well as Ron Paul would have done ending the forever wars?
That's a big thing. You know what? That's a good counter argument. No, I don't think so, because again, she's part of an imperialist class that really does dig their foreign warfares, and Ron Paul at least was against that. But again, I don't know what Ron Paul's motivations were. Kind of sounded always to me at this point in life, like after reading so much about him and, like, you know, talking about what he's talking about. I think the only reason why he's against wars is because, and again, this would be frank, I think it's because he thinks a lot of white kids are dying for Jews in Israel. And I don't know if that's a really good reason why you're against this stuff. Again, you should be against these wars because, again, they're forever, they're corporatists, they're, again, like, they're a money-making machine. I mean, it's every bad tenet of, like, 1984 by George Orwell. That, again, I question his motivations, but again, would he have done something? Absolutely, I think he would have. And that's a big thing for me that would be good. Yeah, I question his motivations a lot, especially after that tweet, and also you get into the history of his newsletters. It's pretty ugly. Now, Gary Johnson, this seems like, you know, would not be a bad guy. I think he would probably do some things, but Gary Johnson also, you know, half the time, I know it seems like a gotcha moment. You know, his whole thing was like Aleppo. Like, what's that? That seemed goofy to me. And it's just like, I don't know. It's just, it's. I wish we could, again, like, you know, have better people than you can, like, I mean, if the short list is Nancy Pelosi, Gary Johnson, Ron Paul, Arnold Schwarzenegger, it's like, okay, well, how many, which turd do you want?
Yeah. You know? I will add one thing to the Gary Johnson thing. I'm going to say turning lemons into lemonade. Mm-hmm. How have you ever heard a politician say, I don't know, and be honest about something like that? Like, every other politician would have, like, deflected and given a politician answer.
Right. I remember, circling back to Newsom for a second, I went to a rally, or I think it was the first time Newsom was running for governor. He was going up against Jerry Brown. And then I think he gave up in the primary. I don't know if this, my timeline is right, but he was over in Long Beach and people were asking him questions, and Gavin Newsom had an amazing ability to say so much and not commit to anything. I'd never seen someone actually talk in circles like him. Like, it really was quite a skill. I mean, it was kind of like, I would put it up there. You know, you used to work in sports radio once upon a time, right?
Yes.
And so, you know, I think I brought this up, that sports radio has this amazing ability to talk about nothing for like about 4 hours. You know, it's sure like they talk about trade, you know, they talk about like, what else? You know, whatever last trade it was, or like what coach got into hot water because he said that this other player was a punk, and the punk player came back and, you know, said he was old and fat, and that was, you know, quite a kerfuffle. Gavin Newsom has a level of like sports talk radio where it's just like, it's just blather. It really is. Again, you could not pin this guy down. This was like, again, trying to pin Jell-O to a wall with Newsom. So, you know, Johnson coming and actually saying, like, I don't know something is actually pretty commendable. Because, again, most of the time it doesn't happen. However, he said it in the circumstance where it's like, you kind of should have known this one because it's kind of a deal.
Yeah. Well, that's one thing I liked about his vice presidential pick, Bill Weld, is like the ultimate insider when it comes to like knowing all what's going on. Like, he just seems like a guy who takes a bottle of scotch and like 10 newspapers and that's his morning.
And, it's almost like the Churchill way of life, you know. It's just you read and you drink and you, it's like, again, you know, I never watched the show, but I just know this part of Game of Thrones. Was that I drink and I know things?
Yes. Bill Weld gave one of the greatest comebacks in the history of life, because he is like very old New England, very much like my ancestors. And someone was like, oh, your relatives came over on the Mayflower. And he was like, that is not true. We sent the servants first to get the cottage in order.
That's a good way of putting it.
I thought that was such a great response. Bill Weld, interestingly enough, was on the fast track to be like a Republican presidential nominee. He went at the Republican convention and talked about how gay rights and abortion were important issues, should be important issues to the Republican Party because of personal freedom. When Bill Clinton won, he was going to make him ambassador to Mexico, but Jesse Helms stopped that because of what he said at the convention. And he was, the hardcore right betrayed Bill Weld, which was a shame. He was a really good governor of Massachusetts. Like I said, socially liberal. And I was reading, I know you're not a big fan of Milton Friedman, but he there was a book of his where he brought up this real interesting point. It reminded me of Bill Weld, and maybe he provoked some thoughts with you. Mm-hmm. Social programs, more often than not, begin being successful. But a lot of social programs are meant to be like an adrenaline shot and are not meant to be long-term solutions, how they're constructed.
Sure.
So his point was, I think he said something like every, I think it was 10 years, like you should re-vote on things and things in the budget.
Have a sunset clause. It's kind of like, again, like, you know, kind of like just like the setting sun, all of a sudden then you have to come back to it.
Yeah. And I know of the sunset clause. I don't know if that's what exactly he was referring to, although he probably was, but yeah, like there's a lot of times where people get entrenched. And this is especially the Democratic side, where you get in bed with certain unions who get all these cush jobs. And like, you could take those resources and keep them in the same field, but people, they don't want to like change because they like what they're comfortable with. And there's a lot of times, like I said, a social program, if it's adjusted, could become more effective. But I think a lot of times, especially I've seen, at least when I was working in Title I schools, there's a lot of stuff that they're doing that's just backwards that they need to dramatically change. That's one thing I'm hopeful with the California National Party, with a lot of the programs we talk about, like the negative income tax and UBI, to get rid of the social programs, like just give people the direct funds and make it be enough so no one goes poor.
I mean, I like that stuff too. I mean, like, again, like, you know, in the last time we talked, I mean, I have certain caveats about that. However, I think what you're getting towards and what I am on board with as well is that if California goes independent, it becomes like a blank slate. We can start over here. You know, we don't have all that stuff kind of hanging in. Like, you know, I forget, there's a particular term in political science. I forget what exactly it is, but it's talking about how, and this is something conservatives bring up all the time, and I think it's a halfway legitimate point, even though conservatives most of the time are just hysterical and ridiculous, and I can go all day on that. But one of the points that they make is that, you know, the bureaucracies do get entrenched, and they always want more funds, and they always want to justify their existence. You know, so when they're always justifying their existence, it's like they're never going to say that, like, the program should be wrapped up or, again, should be changed. They like how it is, because, again, when people have jobs, especially in an entrenched bureaucracy, it's comfortable. They think they're doing the right thing. They're not really that much open to change. Like conservative in like the lowercase c sense. Like, they're just conservative as in, like, we've always done it this way, so why would we ever change? And unless you have this kind of sunset clauses and actually kind of make sure that, okay, maybe in the future we need to revisit this and actually talk about actually if this is working the way we want to. Yeah, these bureaucracies kind of like fight back, and it becomes problematic because, again, they just start developing and kind of like growing like a cancer on like the budget. I think most of the time these programs are for the better, but again, I think it's always healthy to revisit these things. Fortunately, you know, in our American political system, it seems like we can't revisit anything. You know, yeah. Constitutional things like we can't revisit. Like, for example, the way the Senate is set up, California is like a country that has more population than Canada, but we get two senators. We can't revisit that with the current system as it is. You know what I mean? So like, there's all these little things that, again, all of a sudden it's just like locked in, and it becomes like almost like, you know, a papal bull or biblical writ, and we can't talk about how to actually fix this. And you know, or maybe it's like, oh yeah, this is not working the way we wanted it to, or again, like maybe we need to readjust. It's like becomes almost impossible to talk about.
No, I agree 100%. And you also, it's so, and this, I guess this is with gerrymandering too, like. And maybe just with liberalism in general, a Democrat is not allowed to reduce the budget, even if they are making the budget more streamlined. And you can make the argument, I'm sure you've seen the movie Moneyball, just because a team has a lot of, just because you're spending a lot of money, doesn't mean you're going to be as effective as someone who's spending less money smartly.
Right.
That's one thing that drives me nuts about California. And it, I guess you could say with any one party state is the bloat.
Well, because again, like, you know, one party states become very corrupt because, again, when you know that you're always going to be reelected, you can do whatever the hell you want. If you don't have that competition system one way or the other, again, you can just keep going forever. There needs to be some kind of like, you know, so, you know, if you're always thinking over your shoulder that someone's going to be taking my job, if I don't do a good job, I have to make certain things happen. And I have to make sure that, like, you know, I'm justifying my existence. You know, it's again, it's almost like market competition, which is, you know, I'm a socialist, but I do think that, again, the idea of market competition is very important because, again, it keeps people on their toes. Now, again, how this goes about, who owns the means of wealth, there we can go all day on that stuff. But if there is that kind of competition, you will keep on top of things. You won't allow things just to slide or try to get away with, like, hey, you know, my idiot brother is going to be the county commissioner here. So like all this little kind of crap that kind of crumbs up when you have a system that is stagnant. Stagnation is, again, the biggest enemy of any one party system. And California, it will be reaching that pretty soon, the way things are going. If there isn't an alternative to the Democrats, which right now there really is not. The Libertarians will never get the kind of numbers. The Green Party will never get the kind of numbers. The only kind of competition thus far that's probable is either the California National Party or an actual break inside the Democratic Party with the Democratic Socialists.
I think we're that, as the California National Party, with a twinge of old school Republican or left-leaning Libertarian. I took, I don't think it's the most accurate thing in the world, but I took the political compass test the other day.
That's always a fun one, yeah.
And I am like literally in the bottom left corner. I am left-leaning Libertarian. I like made Gandhi look like a conservative, which I was shocked at. I thought I would be more in the center, but yeah, I was left-leaning. I think I've told you this before. If I was just looking at national politics, I'd be a Libertarian at the federal level and Green Party at the state level, just because I think it's easier to yell at a state senator than a U.S. senator.
But yeah, it pretty much is easier. It's just, unfortunately, a lot of people kind of, because our system is very large and bloated on the federal level. I'm just talking Congress. I'm not even getting to like social programs. I mean, specifically like Congress. The fact that we have all this focus on these senators and congressmen, and we forget our local officials. You know, we forget they're existing, and actually they have more power over us than the federal government does. Even though the federal government is very, you know, overstretched and, you know, very overbearing. If you take a moment and think about, like, again, like your city councilmen are making things happen that will directly affect you right away. You know, your state assemblyman is actually going into meetings and having debates over laws about your education system. And your state senator is doing the same thing too. But we kind of forget about this because, again, our country is so large that we immediately focus on the big events. Like, you know, again, who's senator, who's president, these things. If California goes independent, you know, I think that maybe we can draw back and start paying more attention to our locales, which I think, again, because, again, I'm a full-out socialist. There's a lot of libertarians out there. I think if I was a libertarian, I'd be more intrigued about something where my assemblyman represents, like, you know, 40,000 people instead of, like, what is it now, like 500,000 in California, something ridiculous.
There's also, I got to send you the video. Have you heard of a comedian named Dave Smith?
No, not a fan.
He does a podcast with Louis Gomez and Jay Oakerson called The Legion of Skanks. It's a pretty popular one.
I like the name already.
He's a pretty prominent libertarian, but he did a video on U.S. He called it secession, and he talked about how America needs to break up. It was all about balkanization. It was super interesting. But he's a libertarian. And gosh, the Libertarian Party is more crazily diverse than just about any party. There are white supremacists to anarchists to moderate Republicans to left-leaning libertarians, where their priority is ending the forever wars, crony capitalism, and protecting the environment. And then it's almost like
I would have to care, but I understand what you mean. So yeah, it's a very diverse party,
filled with crazy people. Being from New Hampshire, Vermin Supreme is a state treasure to us.
Well, I mean, it's just like New Hampshire. What's the phrase? Live free or die.
Oh yeah, it's the most hardcore state motto of all time.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, and it's it does sum up New Hampshire very well. I know there was a project where libertarians were trying to have like a mass exodus from the other parts of the United States and move into New Hampshire to flip it as like
a whole. It's happened. State. I'll tell you, the town next to me, there's this, oh my gosh, they're the worst libertarians ever. One of them was literally one of the coordinators for the Charlottesville rally, but they're called the Free Cleaners or the Robin Hooders. And they used to just go around and put coins in the parking meters, which sounds like a great thing, right?
Yeah.
These guys would just harass the parking police guy. He's an Iraq war vet, just some normal dude. And they would just call him a murderer, child killer all day, record him on YouTube.
Yeah, that's a normal response. I mean, it's just like, we can all say that parking meter maids are kind of annoying, but, you know, I don't think we're going to have to, you know, pin the entire destruction in the Middle East on these people.
Oh, well, these guys did. They literally, the whole town just hates them. But, like, there's nothing they can, you know, they follow all the laws. Well, there you have it. Another episode of the Free the Bear podcast. Thank you very much for listening. If you can, give it a thumbs up. Even if you didn't like it, give it that good old thumbs up and subscribe. I'm very old, but I've been told there is a bell that you're supposed to push or ding or something. So do that. For more information about the California National Party, go to californianational.party or on Twitter, vote_CNP. And in conclusion,
Free the Bear. Grrr.